Expected inflation and the Phillips curve. In the previous video, we did talk about the Phillips curve, but we ignored the role of expectation. One of the very first people who talked about the importance of expectation when we talk about the Phillips curve was Milton Friedman. And in order to understand his argument, we need to go back to 15.5 and look at the data. What happened to the Phillips curve over time? Let's scroll down. On the x-axis, you have the unemployment rate, and note that as you move to the right, unemployment rate decreases, and on the y-axis, you have the inflation rate. And these dots represent data from the US. These curves show the Phillips curve from each era. Look at the Phillips curve of the 1960s. Remember the conventional wisdom behind this curve? As the labor market tightens, as the unemployment falls, inflation increases. But look what happened to the Phillips curve by the early 1970s. It shifted upwards in that period. What did it mean? This meant that in the 1960s, the unemployment rate of 6% was associated with an inflation rate of around 1%. But by the early 1970s, the same unemployment rate of 6%, was now associated with a much higher rate of inflation, 4%. By the late 1970s, the same unemployment rate of 6% was now associated with an inflation rate of 10%. So the Phillips curve was continuously shifting upwards. And why was that happening? Because of expectations. And that's what we're going to turn to now. So let's scroll down and go back to where we started our video, 15.6 expected inflation, the Phillips curve. And let's scroll down. As before, we start our analysis at equilibrium. This total level of employment, which is associated with 6% unemployment rate, our economy is at the equilibrium. Neither the workers nor the firms have an incentive to change their behavior. But this time, this equilibrium happens at 3% inflation. And everybody expects this inflation. So in other words, what does this mean? It means that the prices increase by 3% year after year after year, and everybody expects this inflation. So what's going to happen? The prices are going to increase by 3%. And since everybody expects this, the nominal wages are also going to increase by 3%. So in fact, the real wages are going to remain the same, and the workers are going to keep putting the same effort as below, and the total level of employment in the economy is going to remain the same, and unemployment is going to stick to 6% year after year after year. So our economy is stabilized at 6% unemployment rate and 3% inflation. Now let's imagine you have a positive demand shock as before. For whatever random reason, people start to buy more and more goods and services, the firms hire more people, therefore the unemployment rate goes down from 6% to 3%. Now here, again, a bargaining gap opens up. In order to keep their workers motivated, the firms increase their nominal wages by 5%. And also increase the price of their goods by 5% in order to keep their markups the same and maximize profit. So here you see this year the inflation rate of 5% is actually the combination of expected inflation, the usual inflation of 3%, which everyone expected, plus this 2% of bargaining gap. But the story does not end there. Why? Because the workers are disappointed. Why they're disappointed? Because they thought that a 5% increase in their nominal wage would translate into a 2% increase in their real wages. Why? Because they were expecting the inflation to be 3%. But that expectation turned out to be wrong. Inflation ended up being 5%, therefore wiping out all the benefits of the increase in nominal wages. So, at the unemployment rate of 3%, the real wages actually didn't change, so the workers were not motivated to work productively. So what's going to happen? In the next round, the workers are going to update their expectation, and this leads to shifting up of the Phillips curve. And we see that if we scroll down. As mentioned, workers and firms update their expectation in the next round, and this would shift up the Phillips curve. This means that at the unemployment rate of 3%, now the workers expect the inflation to be 5% now. This means that they would require a nominal wage increase above 5% in order to stay motivated at this unemployment rate of 3%. So when the Phillips curve shifts up, the same level of unemployment rate is now associated or gets associated with much higher rate of inflation. But bear in mind that we made a very important assumption here, and that was that inflationary expectations are shaped by past experience of inflation. The workers expect the inflation to be 5% this round. Why? Because it was 5% the previous round. And if inflation turns out to be 7% this round, the workers would expect the inflation of 7% the next round. And this is not necessarily the case all the time. The inflationary expectations in some contexts may not be shaped by what has happened in the past. So you need to have that in the back of your mind. Before we finish, let me go back to the wage setting curve and the Phillips curve. As I'm recording this video on October 2021, the global economy is going back to normal. And people are talking about the prospect of high inflation. Why? Because of the positive demand shock. As the economy is recovering, people are spending more and more. And in order to analyze the effect of this positive demand shock on inflation, we need to go back and analyze what's happening at the labor market to the expectation and connect that to the aggregate story of the Phillips curve, the relationship between employment and inflation. So, one part of the story is a positive demand shock. The other part of the story is the shortages in labor and bottlenecks in the supply chain, a negative supply side shock. And these shortages leads to higher prices. In other words, it shifts up the Phillips curve. So we got two things happening at the same time, a positive demand shock and a negative supply side shock. Now, what's the prospect of the economy falling into a vicious circle of wage increases and price increases? For that to happen, three things have to be present. First, the wage that firms set have to be updated by expected inflation. The second one, which is very, very important, is that the expected inflation has to be updated by past inflation. And finally, a positive bargaining gap have to persist. In other words, the positive demand shock have to persist. If these three factors are present, we're gonna have a vicious circle of wage increases and price increases. Very resembling of what happened in the 1970s, the stagflation of 1970s, which we discussed in Unit 15.7. Now think about the similarities and differences between then, the 70s, and now.